this would start. What?
How can people do the sponsor?
Huh?
Tell them how they can become a sponsor.
How they can become a sponsor?
Yeah, tell them how.
You want me to tell them how to... Oh, they can become a sponsor of this?
They can sponsor these.
They can sponsor these?
Yeah.
And I'm going to act like I don't know that? Right now? This is a great idea. Okay, so, did you know you can become a sponsor of these live feeds? That's right. Just check out info@massivachamber.com. Send us an email if you're interested. We'll send you some information. Thank you for tuning in. I see you guys are all adding in there. This is a test right now. We're getting our bearings together. Hey, did you check out this sponsor right here? They're going to be helping out this time. How about this sponsor? Huh? And always, check out MessinaChamber.com. It's just a test. We'll be with you in a short moment. Any second now. It's coming, I swear. How's that weather today, huh? Nothing yet? Just a test. We're just getting everything going. This is a vibe right now. I literally am standing in front of a camera doing this. You know. Oh, are we about to start? Not yet. Oh, okay. Almost there. Did I do the sponsor? I did the sponsor, didn't I? Oh, here's the sponsor. Wish this would start. What?
How can people do the sponsor?
Huh?
Tell them how they can become a sponsor.
How they can become a sponsor?
Yeah, tell them how.
You want me to tell them how to... Oh, they can become a sponsor of this?
They can sponsor these.
They can sponsor these?
Yeah.
And I'm going to act like I don't know that? Right now? This is a great idea. Okay, so, did you know you can become a sponsor of these live feeds? That's right. Just check out info@massivachamber.com. Send us an email if you're interested. We'll send you some information. Thank you for tuning in. I see you guys are all adding in there. This is a test right now. We're getting our bearings together. Hey, did you check out this sponsor right here? They're going to be helping out this time. How about this sponsor? Huh? And always, check out MessinaChamber.com. It's just a test. We'll be with you in a short moment. Any second now. It's coming, I swear. How's that weather today?
played Sunday, and the forecast was rain for tonight.
15-second warning, we did.
Didn't really play a lot of that basketball game last night.
Interesting game. 14-1. Take the punch, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Remind you, if you could please silence your electronic devices, we greatly appreciate it. Call Village of Messina Board of Trustees meeting for April 4th, 2017 to order. Roll call Mr. Offo.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Carville.
Here.
Mr. Deshaies is here. Mr. LeBeer.
Here.
I'm here. First item on the agenda is budget hearing on the mayor's tentative budget. Entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
Move.
Mr. Carville, second by Mr. LeBeer. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Go through the budget, and then we will open up an opportunity for public comment, questions, and of course, trustees. This chart here depicts the tax levy history since 2003. The current tax levy that I'm proposing is 2.95%. Tax rate per thousand, 1609. Still hasn't leveled off, but trying to get close to that. Talk about the appropriated fund balance. I've applied $681,000 in fund balance this year to the budget. That's a significant increase over the last two budgets that I presented. I believe fund balance has two purposes. One is a rainy day fund, so something that unanticipated happens, we can cover that. And then secondly, the fund balance is used for, you know, putting some money away for specific projects or ideas that we have coming up in the near future. An example of that, you know, this year we took a significant hit on healthcare, and so that's why that fund balance is so big this year, and we'll explain that a little bit as we go forward. Unassigned fund balance, that's what's left. As you can see, the year before I took office, our fund balance was dangerously low, below $500,000. We've done a pretty good job of getting that up there, and our current projections from the treasurer at the end of this fiscal year, our fund balance will be in the general fund over $2 million. Revenue versus expense, like every local government, particularly in the North Country, we're seeing declining in our revenues, and our expenses continue to rise, and we know what's driving those costs, and we'll talk about that in a few minutes also. The summary of how it's broken down, you can see how we break it down. Employees and public safety are the biggest expenses for local government. The second column there, under department, those are the requests made by the departments when they came in. This is what I'm proposing to fund them at. So they came in at 6.8. Reduce those requests to 5.7, which cut about 16.63% off the request. Everyone likes to know what 1% means to the tax base. It's $55,430. So to get to a 0% tax levy increase, the trustees will have to cut $163,516. To get to the tax cap, which is 1.3%, consistent with inflation this year, have to cut $91,500. So currently as proposed, 2.95% increase. Of course, that's done by reviewing request actual expenses versus requested expenses and try to factor in everything we think what the department has as to what we've anticipated for expenses. Break down the cost. Local government, 76% is personnel cost. Wages, and benefits. Local government's about providing services. If we require people to provide those services, our employees, employees cost money. Value of taxable property in the village, we continue to see a decline, although this is the smallest decline that we've had in recent years, about 0.4% this year, or $1.3 million in the assessed value of our properties here in the village. That's both commercial and residential reduction.
So it's pretty insignificant.
What's that?
It's insignificant this year.
Right. So I want to talk a little bit less about the budget, and because we're going to have lots of time to talk about that, but more about recent successes and future strategies that we're looking to employ here. We talked a lot last year about this, and we've been talking to trustees, and we've been talking a lot about this, you know, the difference between community development, economic development, job creation, and controlling costs. And those are the things that we can sort of control or have some impact here at the local level when we're dealing with the budget. What's the difference? It's important to know the difference. Community development versus economic development. Community development is the process for making a community a better place to live and work. Economic development is about creating wealth. I have long believed that local government, number one, we don't do economic development well, and secondly, we can have very little impact on it. We can do community development very well. We can improve our parks. You know, the school district can improve the education system. We can improve the healthcare system. There's a lot of things that we can improve. We can improve our infrastructure, our quality of life. We can control that here. We can't control economic development so well at the local level. It has to be done on a regional level. We have to be a player in that. We always have to be a player in that. Areas of focus for community development, education, healthcare, recreation, developing our amenities. Make this a place people want to live, a place that people want to visit, a place where companies want to bring their businesses. Improved housing, infrastructure, public safety, government services, and improving the downtown core. Strategic planning, and then grant writing, competitive funding is the way that we do community development. Since taking office in 2014, we've applied for $3.2 million in outside funding. That's various programs from different federal government, state government, those types of things. We've been awarded $2.4 million. Currently pending, we have $476,000 in grants and other applications that are out there. So if you back the pending out, we're writing successful applications at about 87%. That's pretty good. That's real good. And that's all done because of strategic planning. We're not just applying for grants, throwing them out there and hope we get them. We sit down with our department heads. What are we going to apply for? How's it going to affect us? What's the benefits of it? Then we sit down with our strategic development team, and you know, they research funding that's available, and then we try to match those two things up. And they've done a really good job of that, as you can see from those numbers. And we're bringing funding in here to make a difference. That's how we develop this community using those LSI resources and funding. We have to skim the game. Most of the grants that we write and those other things, we've got to put some money in ourselves. So we have skin in the game, and that actually increases our chance for success. I think we have to transition away from the economic development model and go to the community development model, period. And we've been talking about it, at least I've been talking about it, a number of people up here have been talking about it, but we have to actually do it. Stop talking about it and do it. Get away from the economic development model and go to a full, complete community development model here at the local level, the village and the town government. We got to do it sooner than later. Doesn't mean we're going to forget about economic development. We're still going to be a key player. We're still going to work with the Regional Economic Development Council and the San Lawrence County Economic Development Strategy. We're still going to work with DANC and the Augsburg Bridge and Port Authority and all those things that we're working with them now. We're going to continue to do that. We've got to continue to support current businesses here, help them thrive, help them improve and expand when they can. We've got to work to attract new developments and job creation, but that can't be our focus at the local level. That has to be done on a regional level. So I'm proposing in this budget that we continue our strategic development planning and pursuing those funding opportunities. We continue our efforts on the regional level with economic development, and then we transition away from the BDC model as we know it to a planning office, some structure of a planning office. Talked a little bit earlier, or mentioned controlling costs. We know in local government, it's benefit and wages, and it's pretty consistent. It stays at about 76%. Maybe jumps a little bit once in a while, but that's a consistent cost. How do we control that cost? Pretty challenging. It's easy for people to say, and I think we all do it when you run for office, you're going to go in there and you're going to just cut things. There's very little left to cut other than people. And if we cut people, we're cutting services. And when we don't provide a service, my phone rings off the hook. So as a community, we have to decide if we're going to cut people, what services can we live without? We talk about this at our department head meetings every Monday morning about what are the services that we're providing that maybe we can't do anymore, or we shouldn't be doing, or we should resource out to people. But that's where we are. We're going to shrink the size of village government, shrink the size of our budgets. That's the way we have to go. General fund expenses, about controlling cost. Not getting cheaper to do business. Next Monday, April 10th at 5:15, we have two local government specialists from the Department of State coming in. They're going to present to us on the various programs, there's a couple programs out there that the state likes you to proceed if you're going to look at restructuring your government. Restructuring means, of course, consolidation, dissolution, merging, various things. We do a really good job here in Michigan. Most of our departments with the town and village that we share, or we merge them. Joint Rec's an example of that. Our HUD office, our code enforcement, our fire department, those are examples of how we're sharing services to save taxpayers' money. But, you know, we say it's saving taxpayers' money, but those services are still expensive. So I think we have to look at it. There's been three studies done. The last one was done in, I think, 94. It's time to look at it again. Things have changed. The landscape here has changed. And the belief at the state level, too, has changed. So there's more support for these concepts. I think for this to work, well, I know for this to work, people sitting at this table have to go into it with an open mind. People sitting at the town board have to be going into it with an open mind. I've invited the towns of Norfolk and the towns of Louisville to come because they, both of them have portions of their township in the village here, or I should say we're in their townships. So we all have to go with an open mind. I'm doing that. Whatever the study, in my view, wherever the study comes, the conclusions that come out of that, we should look at them seriously and see what we can do to shrink the size of local government. We're a community of 12,000 people, almost 13,000 people. We've got far too much government here. Budget itself, those are the numbers. Thanks to the staff for all their hard work. We talked actually next year, we're going to expand the budget process. They're real happy to hear about that, to create more time. It seems like we're always crunching at the end to try to get this thing out. Schedule of the hearings coming up, one on Thursday, three next week. Of course, the Department of State on Monday is here. And then we'll adopt it on either the 12th or the 25th. If we can get everything done by the 12th, we'll adopt it then. If not, we'll come back after spring break on the 25th and make the adoption. So just really briefly here at the end, again, I just want to be a little bit more specific on the community development stuff. I highlighted the areas that I thought we should be focusing on. You know, and if you look at the education system, that's really turned around here in Messina. Full-time superintendent, you're seeing increases in state aid. They're doing better things. Education has to be, education is the key to any success of any community. We've got to educate our students, and we have to fund education appropriately. And it's good to see that our school system is much more steady than it was a few years ago. Healthcare system, we have a great healthcare system here, our hospital, the service providers that are here. We have to continue to make sure that we have a hospital here in this community. All those other things that are listed there. So We're not just talking about community development, we're actually doing it. We've been doing it for a number of years, the village has, and the town has been working with us on it. You know, there are some simple things, but increased recycling, for example. We've increased recycling, and we're talking about what we're going to do with our refuse fund. Our refuse fund is very good right now. It's excellent, as a matter of fact. So we're in the next, in a couple, next few weeks or month, we'll be coming out with some ideas there of how we're going to fund future projects there, save some money. We're looking at the rates, all those things. So, and it's done because we're just doing things better. We're going to close the footbridge project this year. It's going to be bidded here in the spring, and we're going to get that thing done after many years of not getting it done, and with the assistance of the state DOT. The increased funding we've talked about, substantial. That's big money that comes in. We adopted complete streets policy. A simple way of community development. We put sidewalks on School Street. Sounds like a small thing, but the safety of our students and our kids getting to and from school is important. The core of the community, we had 17 applications, I'm told, by the BBC this last week to take advantage of that program funded by the RVRDA. That's going to be good. It's going to improve the downtown core with facade improvements, signage, rental subsidies, and interior build-out, so that'll be good. Moving Messina Forward Coalition is going to make their presentation on May 3rd on the items that we're recommending that this community focus on. Community development, of course. Boys and Girls Club's a great example. We're about to open that facility over there. It's almost done. It'll be a great place for our kids to go after school. We expanded the housing office. We made a real big effort. We contracted with the Development Authority of the North Country, and we're currently we have three grants that we're working on, and I'm sure we're going to apply for another one this year. So we're not just talking about blight. We're trying to enforce it, but we're also getting the resources that people need to improve their properties. It's going to make a real big difference in quality of life for many people, but also help our neighborhoods. Our code office has done a real good job on the zombie properties and all those other things that are facing the community with respect to that. Restore New York, Slavens Building. By this time next year, that's very likely going to be back on the tax rolls and vibrant with businesses in it and people living above it. Water Street Park, as soon as the DOT vacates it after the project on the bridge, we have substantial improvements that are going to go over that park and to the waterfront down there. The 1 gig broadband project, the Northern Board of Regional Commission grant that was received on that, they're working on it now. We're going to authorize a bid tonight to go out to bid on the portion of the project that goes out to the mall, so we're doing things on that. And I wanted to really quickly touch on the heroin problem. We have an aggressive enforcement strategy. The chief and I meet almost daily. He updates me on what's going on. He has an aggressive enforcement strategy that he's working with his staff and other people to deal with it. We know we can't arrest our way out of it. It's going to take a number of other ways to do it. You have to think in terms of the heroin problem. It's a generational problem. It's not going away anytime soon. We're stuck with that thing for 15 or 20 years. The key is to prevent the next generation from turning to heroin. We have to help those that are afflicted by it now. We have to do everything we can and all the resources we can to deal with the current problem, including the public safety. But we're stuck with that problem. We've got to prevent the next generation. We just opened the office at the Community Center for the Messina Drug Free Community Coalition 2 days a week. There's someone in there, a resource office. So anyone can go in there that needs help. Maybe you're a family member. Maybe you have a son or a daughter that has heroin issues. Maybe you yourself have an issue. You don't know where to turn. You can go into that resource office. It's staffed with a highly qualified individual who can point you in the right direction to get services. So that's at the Community Center 2 days a week. Additionally, she's in the high school. She's been operating an office there for a year or more. So we put that office in the high school for a while. Now we're expanding it to the community. We have a teen clubhouse at risk that's going to be opening, again, grant funded. That's going to be downtown, and people that are in danger of becoming users or in recovery will be able to go there in the evening. There'll be three qualified staff people, counselors, and people that can assist them and try to keep them on the straight and narrow. And it's the comprehensive approach we're taking with the Drug Free Community Coalition to make sure that we're dealing with the heroin problem. So we're not just talking about community development, we're actually doing it. And I think if we put the resources that we're using locally to try to do economic development and the community development, we can improve this community even more. With that, I will open it up to the public for comments and or questions, and then of course the trustees. Comments?
I guess Charlie. It's me, Tim.
Yes, sir. Mind if I sit, Charlie?
No, that's all right. You don't mind if I sit.
You know, the budget's always been an issue that I've been interested in. You know, the ever-increasing municipal taxes are driving business out of New York. That's the largest the reason for the exodus from here is local taxes. And over a period of years, we've seen our village taxes become, and those of us who have the star, have become the highest tax we pay. It used to be the lowest one in June. So you do have quite a challenge, and I know that your employee costs are what's driving this. I mean, if you have 3/4 of your costs are employee costs, I don't know how well you negotiate your contracts, but you know, it seems that there are continuous pay increases, you know, an annual pay increase, which if the person spends 25 years working for the village, 50 cents on every dollar is for life that we give them today. Their final average salary is going to be 3 years, and so 50 cents for life if you give them a dollar raise today. And I don't have a problem with people making more money, but I have over 1,000 people that come through my office every spring, and I see how much money they make. Everyone in this area, the best paid people are public employees. The very best healthcare plans by far are public employee healthcare plans. The most expensive ones are public employee healthcare plans. So the private sector is becoming less wealthy, while the public sector is getting pay increases, having their healthcare benefits paid for. I'm not sure if you negotiate a price of healthcare or just that we'll take care of your healthcare thing. And you know what has happened with healthcare costs. You know, they've skyrocketed. So if all of a sudden I just have free healthcare regardless of cost, well, that's a pretty good deal. But the taxpayers, they're not getting that. The private sector taxpayers are not getting increases in anything. And I see that every day, you know, and I know that it's a difficult challenge for you to tell these people that you've worked with, and you've benefited, and Francis, you've benefited from the village's budgets for years, but those years were prosperous years in Messina. We all grew up when our parents got good jobs. We had good jobs, and now we're retired, so everything was good for us. It's not that way anymore. We've got fewer people paying, reduced assessments. For decades, the assessors raised our assessments because we all felt good about our houses were worth more money. And so the leaders said, well, we didn't raise your taxes. The assessments went up and kind of let you off the hook for quite a while. Now that can't happen. There's no legitimate reason to raise people's assessments anymore. So our employee costs are driving us, the taxpayers, out of here. And I don't know, you know, do the employees participate in their health care costs, or are they just covered under the contract? Are they participating?
They pay a contribution. In fact, an increase in the contribution was just negotiated.
Okay, but is a substantial contribution or you know, do they pay a third of it, a half of it, a quarter of it, 10%, 5%? You know,
nowhere near those numbers.
Yeah, it's like, but I see the value. A family policy is about $22,000, is what the cost is to the taxpayer per employee. The school budget benefits, $35,000 average employee benefit at the school this past year. And the taxpayers have got to pick that up. And I, you know, again, I'm just telling you, this is the perspective from the taxpayer. You know, you mentioned your greatest challenge was declining revenues. And the greatest challenge for those of us out here are keeping our expenses within the revenues that we're going to get. We can't just raise our price under threat of confiscating someone's home in order to get more money for our employees and the services that we provide or want to provide. And if the citizens of this community want all of the services and they're happy with the cost of the services, then they should have it and they should pay for those costs. But I'm giving you a different perspective, and 2.9%, we all know that your contracts and the cost of the people are going up, so 2.9% is pretty honorable. You know, to be honest, I can't believe these guys presented you with a 24% increase. They didn't work very hard at it. Made your job much more difficult. I'd encourage them next year not to deliver a 24% until they worked on it a little bit. That'll save you some time. But anyways, that's, you know, that's my looking at budgets in general, and you know, and the public out here who's paying for those budgets. And so, you know, the articles in the newspaper, I try and follow as close as I can, but the government jobs in St. Lawrence County pay the second highest salaries, and they employ the most people. So, you know, taxes are going to drive people out of here. And you don't want to lay anybody off. We don't want to reduce employees. You know, Jimmy Heidi said at one time his main purpose was not to lay anybody off. We don't want to see that. How do we control the costs when you're presented with 24% increases? You know, you're going to make sure it work harder. So I just think that we need to try hard, and I know cuts are unheard of. You know, they're very difficult to do, but, you know, give it your best, please.
Thank you. Further public comment, Mr. Gregory.
My question is more procedural. In years past, when the budget was presented, it was presented by department breakdown. What is the rationale of not doing that? Because it's kind of hard to tell what areas might be driving the budget. Whether you have separate specific departments and department heads. Was there a reason for combining things?
The way I present is the way I've done it for 3 years. Honestly, I can't tell you my rationale 3 years ago was for doing it this way, but. Further public comment. Trustees, I
think? Yeah, what's the BDC, and I'll back you there. Last year, I had an issue with seeing the BDC go away, and I think it's time. I think there's a better way to do things. But what is the plan? Where's the $15K that you have budgeted? Is that to carry us through 12/31? Because we do have some responsibility as far as the town is concerned. I'm not sure what the plan is there.
Well, I think the plan is going to be. When we jointly meet with them in a couple of weeks to see what their thoughts are, and if there's interest to proceed that way, then yeah. I mean, we, as you know, we didn't fund them 2 years ago. Last year we funded them to 15,
right.
So I kept that number in.
Okay.
But I mean, you guys could pull that, increase it. It's up to you. But you're right. I think we have to. If it's going to go away, we've got to decide how to do it. I mean, there's some advantages to having a local development corporation, which is what they are, an LDC. They have assets that have to be dealt with. They've got certain responsibilities right now. They're still administering one grant. They're administering for the community. So how those responsibilities get transitioned, if it happens,
I mean, my guess would be that you have a plan in place.
Okay.
Because I know you well enough to know that you've got a plan in place, and it's probably a good one. I know that we're. You know, we're working, and for the life of me, I always forget the name of this group. I want to call them Volatus, but I can't think of the name. Strategic Development Initiatives, right? SDI.
Right.
I know that we work with them, and they've done some good things for us. What are the chances of us getting a seat at the table with the Regional Economic Development Council? I don't mean somebody from the SENA, I mean you. What are the chances of that happening?
I don't know the answer to that.
Who is the Messina representative right now? Is it somebody from one of the local plans?
Bobby Lake from Messina.
Okay.
someone else too.
I'd really like to see something like that happen. And I realize it's supposed to be apolitical, and I'm not trying to make it political, but. I think Messina would be well served to have a seat at that table. I'm not sure where Alcoa is going to be in a few years. I hope they're here for another 100 years, but I just don't know. Nobody sitting in this room knows. Next one, the police. You probably almost fell out of your chair when I sent you the note, and I'm sure Adam did too, when I said that I'd like to see us get another investigator. The piece you had up there on heroin, it's a disaster in this community. We don't have enough time, and I'm probably preaching to the choir, but I'm talking to the rest of my fellow board members here too. Our investigators don't have enough time to do what they need to do. I love tourism. The tourism that he had to take care of next Friday, those are the type of tourists nobody wants up here. Okay? I'm behind the public safety piece increasing. I'm telling you that right now. I thought I was pretty clear with you. It looks like you've done that in the budget. I haven't seen the final detail of it. We'll probably be taking care of that the 10th, it looked like, right? But is the third investigator in there, or is that your plan?
It was taken out, so you guys are going to put it back up.
Okay. So it's not included in that number?
Correct.
Okay.
Do we have the cost and figures? Will we have that available when we get to the police-specific portion?
Yeah, the chief's working on specific. He's been working. We've been meeting and talking about this for weeks and weeks, and he's going to present a plan to you that night. Okay. That will include all the costs.
I mean, what else is that night? I believe you have three things that night. Monique, do you have that handy right there?
Oh, it's at the end of our...
Because that's going to be a big one. You know what I mean, as far as...
Police and the treasurer and the general budget, so...
So there'll be plenty of time for you know, Julie's piece and
the chief is nice
for his piece as well. Okay. That's, I mean, that goes hand in hand with making this a better place to live. I've spoken with, you know, people that from the outside that I've seen and say, hey, you know, there's a lot of houses for sale in Messina. And I guess why would I want to move to Messina? When I'm driving out of Messina on my way out of here, I see what's walking down the street. And I'm not trying to act like we're above people that are in this town, but some of the tourists that have entered here have they're here for one reason, and that reason's not good. And we've got to just obliterate them, get rid of them, and you guys are doing a good job at it.
Well, and it goes to your point about community development. You know, third investigator recruits the community, and the point you made about community development, it's not that we're focused on one over the other. Community development is actually going to support economic development, because it doesn't matter how cheap the power is, doesn't matter how skilled of a ready workforce you have. If somebody's looking to open a business here or expand a business, if they come up to visit a community and they're not impressed with what they see there, it lessens the likelihood that they would establish here. So it goes hand in hand. If we improve the community development, by also improving public safety, economic development will be a tad bit easier.
My assumption, and maybe it's the wrong one, is that as quick as this started, it could probably be turned around. Maybe I'm wrong. I know at the level here, it's being taken care of fine. I also know that when people stand up in Canton, there's issues there too that need to be taken care of sooner or later. Hopefully not any sooner. We're doing the job here. You throw the cuffs on them and you throw them up there, and pretty soon they found a new place to go in the sea. It's driving them crazy if you can't tell. That's all I've got. Other than that,
thank you, trustees.
We got lots of time to talk.
Entertain a motion to close. Mr. Craig.
I have to agree with Mr. Offeld. I had brought something up to the board about 4 or 5 years ago. I was kind of scoffed at. Local governments really have a lot of power. We've seen nationwide sanctuary cities. Could we look into the possibility of having some sort of mechanism here that if someone comes from another place strictly for criminal behavior, that once they're caught, they're banned? I don't know if there's any way to do it, but to me it's worth looking into. In other words, they're arrested, they're convicted, they're put on a bus. And if you come back here, there's going to, you know. So It's just a thought that if there's some way to prohibit them from coming back here to do what they do.
That's an unsanctuary city.
Right.
That's a good city.
Seeing no other hands?
Yeah, I want to add to that. Ken's right. And you're right, too. Because I remember, wasn't that long ago, you got pretty rough with them down the canyon. And these guys do a hell of a job here. Everybody does a good job here. But as soon as it goes to Canton, it's a black hole. You know, and it's not just the judge. It's not just the DA. It's the probation department. It's a lot of things down there. And you as a board have got to let them know that they're not getting it done. I mean, as citizens, we can tell them, too. But as a board, you got to let them know. It's not getting done, guys. Because they're, it's just not going to happen down there. There's so many problems down there in camp. And you can bring in 50 investigators in here, arrest them, put them all in cuffs. They're going to be back here tomorrow because Canton doesn't have the probation staff, doesn't have this, doesn't have that. That's got to be brought into the mix. Yeah, as soon as possible.
I think fairness, we have to account, and the chief can tell you this too, I mean, the criminal justice system itself is bursting at the seams. It's expensive to operate a jail. We know the condition of the county government and their finances. Probation. There's not enough probation officers. There's, take parole officers in the state. They have a caseload that's unmanageable, unbearable. Same thing with probation people. So the system itself is busting at the seams. We need comprehensive criminal justice reform in this country, not just the state. For the comments, entertain a motion to close the public hearing. Mr. Carvel.
Second.
Second by Mr. Shays. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion to open the public hearing to authorize a tax levy in excess of 2% limit established by the General Municipal Law 3C.
So moved.
Mr. LeBeer.
Second.
Second by Mr. Carvel. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
This is a public hearing. We'll be taking public comment on this, but the purpose of the public hearing for overriding the tax cap is to hear public comment on possible property tax cap override. It's the intention of the Village Board of Trustees to work as hard as they can, if we can, to get the tax rate below the tax cap rate of 1.3%. Because of the property tax freeze credit, we do not want to vote and authorize the override tonight unless we actually are going to adopt a budget that raises the tax above the cap. So in other words, we will not take action on this. We will leave this hearing open, and at the end of the budget work sessions, if we need to override the tax cap, we will in fact vote to do that. If we don't need to, we don't have to take any action. Kind of one just goes away.
It said it's 1.3, correct?
1.3. Rate of inflation. Open up to public comment. Anyone with public comment on the 2% tax cap override? Trustees, anything? Entertain a motion to close the hearing. Mr. LeBeer.
No.
What's that?
We draw my motion.
My apologies, yes. Thank you. Leave that open.
Letter A, dude.
Of course, she's good. Revisions to General Code of the Village of Messina, Chapter 270, Taxi Cabs. Entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Mr. Carvel.
Second.
Second by Mr. LeBeer. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Open. Chief, you want to give us a brief update on the changes?
Sure. A couple meetings ago, there was some edits to the taxi cab that were suggested by the village board and some of the taxi cab operators. So one of the additions that were made was putting a drug screening in. So what's going to happen is they're going to give me their applications. I'm going to do a pre-approval. That way the operators or the owners aren't wasting their $60 to $70. So anything on the back end that I find, I'll tell them if they're going to be pre-approved or not. They'll take their test within 5 days of me giving them the pre-approval. The results will have to be given to me within the 5 days after their tests are performed, so I can continue on in either approval or disapproval. So that's going to be one addition. The second one is we moved the minimum age of the vehicle from 10 years to 12 years. Other than that, everything else was in the compliance that everybody wanted. Those are going to be the two major changes.
Public comment. Trustees, any comments?
Thank you for your work on it.
Do you have a resolution to adopt the local law?
Yes, here.
What's that? Yes. Entertain a motion to close public hearing?
So.
Mr. Rivera.
Second.
Second by Mr. Offeld. Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Entertain a motion for the proposed resolution to adopt the local law.
So.
Mr. Rivera. Second by Mr. Deshaies. Discussion. Resolution poll individual. Mr. Offeld?
Aye.
Mr. Carvel?
Aye.
Mr. Deshaies?
Aye.
Mr. Rivera?
Aye.
Resolution carries. Reports of officers and committees, code enforcement, Mr. Carvel, Mr. Levere.
Have anything? We'll have post budget for a list of proposed changes.
Okay. Economic Development Committee, Mr. Offeld, Mr. Levere.
There'll be a lot coming soon.
Fire Committee, Mr. Carvel, Mr. Levere.
We met with the both the volunteers and the drivers last week.
Got something later on the agenda.
Okay. Personnel Committee, Mr. Carvel, Mr. Deshaies.
Nothing at this time.
Police Committee, Mr. Carvel, Mr. Deshaies.
I met with the chief the other day. I'd just like to commend the police department on their actions that were taken last week. Over the community of the Tim's dad, the tourists from the Utica area. So, good job, and thank you.
Manager.
I just want to thank the community also for their assistance and backing us, and the officers that are out there every day. That it's a hard battle we're at right now, but we're not going to give up.
Recreation Commissioner, Mr. Chase.
We haven't had a meeting last next Tuesday, second Tuesday of the month.
Street Committee, Mr. Offeld, Mr. Levera.
Nothing.
Water and Sewer, Mr. Offeld, Mr. Levera.
We've got a couple things. There's going to be an agreement with the town of Norfolk later on in the agenda that we'll be talking about.
Okay. We're dealing with a water in the basement issue over on Highland Avenue. I'm talking to a resident over there. It's happened in the past. We don't think it's a design problem, so we're not sure if it's maintenance. And Francis, you mentioned this a few times in my office, we're not doing the maintenance we used to do on the systems, and so I just want to kind of put that on your radar screen. I'm going to talk to Superintendent Fadley when he gets back in more detail and just see if there's things that we can do to prevent it. This one particular problem that was caused apparently was grease in the line. But so I don't know if that's a single incident or if it was because systems not being maintained. I'm not sure if we're doing so many things. You know, it's not a criticism of Public Works by any means. I'm just, are we maintaining the system as well as we should?
What's your typical lateral, wastewater lateral?
4 inch.
4 inch, most houses. So, how's the Public Works gonna take care of that? Where's that? Or you think it's further out on the?
Well, if it's in the main, it's that's the Public Works. But once it starts into the lateral, then that's the homeowner's responsibility.
Right. So, what kind of maintenance? And I'm just talking right here. I'm thinking outside of what kind of maintenance could they do to prevent that? And if it wasn't a maintenance problem, would everybody on the street have it?
Well, Yes, what they normally do is that they, if somebody has a problem with their sewer, they're getting water in their cellar, they call the DPW. The DPW comes out, they check the main, they you know, see it, they run the what's called a sewer jet, it's a high pressure water hose from manhole to manhole, whatever section they're in.
Okay.
And then they go to the house and see if it's come out of their house.
Okay.
Now, if it hasn't come out of their house, then they have to get a hold of somebody that has a Roto-Rooter or some kind of a auger to come in there to clean out their own personal line.
Okay.
But, usually the DPW checks it first, sees if it's in the main line.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. But I mean, that wouldn't be something that you just go do, right?
Well, if it depends upon the individual. If they have problems, they got a bunch of trees in the front yard, and they've had problems with roots in the past, you know, it's probably a good idea, maybe, whatever, every 6 months or 9 months or yearly to get a hold of the Roto-Rooter company or whatever, and, you know, auger those, cut those roots out before it causes the line to plug.
Like I said.
You know, some have bellies in them. I mean, there's a lot of different problems out there. So.
Okay, thanks. So 4-inch?
Normally it's a 4-inch line for the normal.
That's what we're here.
You get into commercial or whatever, then you start to
right.
Look at your lines.
That's all. Thanks.
I've got a question about this water. Every year over in Holmcroft, Madison, Washington Street, it helps the problem with flooding there. And we have to do it. And I was informed there is an ordinance. And with all this rain we've been having, I'm sure somebody should be over there taking a look at that, because I was informed somebody lives in that area that they're getting really concerned about it. And it seems like every year in the spring of the year it happens. Something's got to be done permanently.
Is that like the Garfield area?
Yeah, yeah. Madison, yeah. Garfield, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I think in the past, didn't I know there were some issues at one point having the fire department going over there doing it. I thought we made the decision that they could use the equipment to go do it.
We took care of it last year.
Yeah,
right. That's what I thought. So was this something somebody brought up to you, Herb? Or,
yep.
Oh, so there's an issue or there's a pending issue?
Well, yeah, they're looking outside wondering.
It's going now. It says this water's deeply back there.
Talk to Public Works for a
and just a note to that. Bella says, I said, this has happened all the time. Why isn't there a drainage put there? Because it's in the right-of-way, the village right-of-way. And he said, there's a thing that is plugged or something. I don't know, the water's supposed to drain out. I have no idea. Would you know anything about that, sir?
I know something about that.
Oh, thank you.
Is it a 4-inch line?
No. That's a different issue.
Oh.
Initial public comment period. As always, we ask you to please stand and state your name for the record. Initial public comment. Seeing none, old business. Accept bids and authorized sale of fire department 1989 Ford F800 Humper. Mr. Hardy.
Okay, we've had this 1989 FMC Humper on the market. It's been listed with a broker website called Fire Tech for approximately 8-9 months now. And what they do is they take old apparatus, put it online, and people can contact them, tell them what they're looking for, and they try to match people up with it. We've had a few hits, has been super successful. We got a hit the other day from a group in Kentucky. They're very interested in it. They've been emailing them all sorts of information, pictures, specs, everything they could possibly want. They'd like to make an offer for $12,000 for this truck. That's very fair for a 1989 fire truck in the condition that thing is in. I'd recommend that we jump on this one as well due to the fact that in New York State you don't have to title or register a fire truck. So it's very difficult to sell these things to other states without having to wait potentially up to a year or over a year to get a title for it. These folks do not need that. The state of Kentucky's got a form that basically you fill out and states one municipality is selling it to another municipality and they don't have to worry about it either. The way it works with Fire Tech, I will let you know too, that with them listing it and doing all the legwork for us, they do take 10% of the cost, which is very typical for any step of the states.
I will authorize the sale.
Second.
Moved by Mr. Rivera, second by Mr. Carville. Discussion.
I think it's good to get rid of it now. The longer we hold on to it, the less we're going to get. It's just like the other pieces that we had in the past.
I agree.
Specialty item. It's not something you can just, anybody that brother wants it. It's not like a car or a truck.
To add to that, I actually spoke to the folks from the website today. If this thing gets another year older, they won't even list it. There's a window between about 30 and 50 years old. They don't want to touch it. They consider it an antique. They won't try to sell them until it hits past 50 years. It becomes a classic, and then there's a market again for that. So
a follow-up action, I believe we were looking at the possibility of a skid unit.
Yes.
If this was to sell. So.
Yes, if we were to get this sold, we were going to look to a skid unit to be able to do brush fires.
Trustee Carver and myself, I'm sure we'll touch base with you on that.
Sure.
Further comments? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Discussion, Robinson Road Department of Public Works expansion. Have any of you heard anything from the town with regard to...
I was absent from the last meeting, unfortunately. What did you guys discuss at the last meeting?
Our interest is to try to do something jointly with them. What I'm hearing much from that. Supervisor returned to work yesterday after not for a while. You know, two of the council went out of town right now.
But we haven't even received any kind of definitive word on pontoon bridge or that way.
We have not.
So it goes back, for me, it goes back to one of the earliest concerns of what is plan B, C, D, E, and F if these alternate sites don't work out. And if we look at the current DPW site, we have to get that stuff off of where it is. It's just too close. If we're gonna go in the back, my opinion is, and I appreciate the work that was done, if the field is still too close, you look at the wooded area, if you strategically placed it, you could place it in an area that has, at a minimum, 600 feet in any nearby property. So if we're looking for our nothing pans out elsewhere and we decide on current location, that would be my preference. If we're doing current DPW to move away from where we're storing now, move away from even the field and go back a little further to position it furthest away from any property that we can at the current site. My fear is we don't move on that option, and even if we initiate the process, doesn't mean we have to finalize it, but if we don't have the state and the assemblywoman's support and we don't get that passed, and then this thing does end up closing and we have no other alternative, we're going to end up wanting to put it or having to put it where it shouldn't be. So I'm not sure how, at what point do we say we can't wait for answers any longer and at least get the ball rolling with the legislature to swap the property. And again, that doesn't cement it, because ideally, even if we put it somewhere else, I think we should swap that property anyways, because then it's going to make it harder for anyone, not just us, in the future to develop where we currently have those piles. If we make that green belt, it won't matter who's sitting here. They'll have to go back to the assembly to get it undone. And I got to imagine that would be a different task, given the proximity to the homes. That's my thoughts. With the absence of hearing.
We're there, Harvey. You know, the assembly and Senate are in session for about 2.5 more months. I mean, so we're going to get this done. The change in the Greenbelt Preservation District, we gotta move.
I just wish we could get an answer from the town one way or the other. I was up and blocked that piece of land before we had the last big snowstorm.
Pontoon Bridge Road.
Pontoon Bridge Road. It's ideal. The land tails off the road back down in, and when you get down back around the Alcoa property line, there's a high berm right there for when they actually dug the canal many years ago. And the land is all goes down, start from the 131 and coming back down from the where the pontoon bridge used to be, both directions. It's a real differential that goes down in a deep ravine in there. It's the area, I believe, if they put the materials there, you wouldn't even see it from the road. You'd see the access road to come in there, but you would not see it. And if they could work something out at Alcoa, they wouldn't even have to put a road in, because Alcoa already has a road that goes up to a couple structures that they have up there. It must be something to do with the water line that comes from the intake. If they could just get a right-of-way to use that road comes right to the basically the corner of the properties between Alcoa and the town. And you go over the berm and go down in, and it's a deep hole there. You know, it's something that's need the brush there, you know, most of it and everything else, clear the area off. It's not a lot of big trees or anything else that has to be taken care of there. To me, it's the ideal spot. It's out of the way. It's not going to affect anybody. I just wish that we could get some sort of an answer, one way or the other, from it. Yes or no. Can we use it or not? If we have to, can we buy it or not? We don't want it all. That's my opinion. We don't want it all. We're just looking for 5 or 6 acres or something in there. The access road, if they need an access road, with the 5 or 6 acres to put the piles in. 60 or 80 acres, something like that, in that parcel. And we would be at the corner of it anyway. We wouldn't be like out in the middle of it where we could, take a chance and, causing a problem for any kind of future development that it might have. I used to ride my bike up there fishing when I was 8 years old, and it hasn't changed since that time. So, it hasn't been used in many, many years, so.
Yes, I discussed earlier, my feelings on that. I agree with Francis. How's the sale of South made? Is that complete?
No, we had some correspondence this weekend. Our attorney and them, it's proceeding. The hope was sometime this month to close.
Do we have, or can we get a definitive date from the Assemblywoman and the Senator in terms of, here's the cutoff. If you guys want us to try to get this through, we need it by X.
Yeah, I'm sure we can get that.
And then in turn, we reach out to the town and say, will you be able to give us your answer?
Yes or no?
By X.
Yeah.
And if they can't give us the answer by that time, I think we have to proceed with the possibility of it's a no. And that way there, if it does turn out to be a no, we at least gave the Assembly enough time. If it turns out to be a yes, we thank the Assemblywoman for her assistance. We have the land swapped, but we don't necessarily do anything with it. And then that still affords a bit more protection to that area. I don't know if that works.
So we have the two engineers go ahead now and draw up a description of what you're talking about. So that we have that ready, and if we need it to whatever date, you'll have to say, well, now all of a sudden now we got to draw a description up, we got to go out and do some measurements. Let's get that part done and just put a case, where it comes to work.
I believe that the town and the two meetings, three meetings we've actually had, and this goes back to mid-December, unfortunately. They agreed to us utilizing an area down on the South Racket Road. Granted, you got the choo-choo train, you got to worry about it. When you're pushed into a corner, sometimes you got to do what you don't want to do. We may have to be there. If indeed there's no rhythm to sell the pontoon bridge road property, and it's kind of discouraging not to be able to get an answer. We're going to meet with them twice in the next 2 weeks? What was the holdup, Tim? I know that you had asked them. Is there are they waiting for? Were there members that they still had to poll?
I don't know what the internal discussions are.
Oh,
so. Okay.
So we don't we know that there's a holdup. We just don't know what the holdup is.
Right.
So that doesn't. I mean, being that as it may, that really doesn't give me a real warm fuzzy that we're going to get the answer that we want. We could be sitting here hoping against hope. Maybe the right move to make is to just take them up on their offer and slide into the South Racketville area.
What would move there? Salt and sand? Then we're still looking at needing another site for other materials, debris, leaves.
What does the town do with their debris, their leaves?
I don't think they collect them.
Maybe we don't collect them anymore. I don't know. Is there really a need to cut down, is there really need when you cut down a tree to have the village pick it up? I just cut down part of a tree in the backyard and it wasn't sitting waiting for John Germano to pick it up, I can tell you that. I took care of it myself.
But where are citizens going? We still have no place for citizens to take it, if that's the case.
What does the town do with it? What do their citizens do? Just throw it in the field? I don't know. We're not, obviously we don't want to do that. Maybe that's something we can talk to them about, but at a minimum, we've got to find a place for sand and salt. Grass clippings, leaves, the other kind of stuff, mulch them. Okay. I didn't put any bags, I put bags out in the past, I didn't this year, just cut them up. I'm not trying to cut services to people. I mean, you really want to get people mad, don't put sand and salt on the road next year. This place will be packed.
Well, that's one of the concerns I would have with the train track. So,
what's that?
Is the delay of getting sand and salt on the road if they get stuck.
What does the town do? They just go the other way, right?
I'll wait for the train.
is there an inconvenience? Are we going to be inconvenienced? Yes. But we sold the piece of property. Guy did a great job. We've got businesses coming in here. You got to take the good with the bad for a little while. It might only be for a couple of years because the town has been saying that, you know, they need to build another facility. I don't think there's any secret there. They do want to build a facility. They haven't decided where they want to do it yet. And maybe if we, you know, by waiting, us temporarily putting something up there, whatever it is that we do, then maybe we could have this joint venture that you talked about. There is money out there. There's still, I think one of the councilmen was arranging a meeting, but it got canceled with Miss Russell's office, I believe. But it got canceled, I think it was weather related. Just to speak about that topic, what money's available for shared facilities. I can tell you, if we build something, and then 2 years later they build something, we're going to be branded as the 10 dumbest people to ever live in the scene. I can tell you that right now. Right? I mean, you guys agree with that?
And rightfully so.
Absolutely. Talking about myself here, too. But I mean, seriously, we've got temporarily. We got to do something. We knew that when the property was sold. No matter what, temporarily you got to do something. It's a matter of where you do it. Pontoon Bridge Road, that'd be perfect for us. But the way that people are talking right now, I don't believe that's going to happen. And I mean, they may have their reasons too. I mean, we're looking at it one sided. Maybe there's another reason. Maybe they're going to put a park in there. Maybe there's going to be a big walking park. Maybe, I don't know, is there bird watching or something? I don't know. I've heard quite a few things that they could put out there.
I think, regardless of where materials, sand, salt end up, I really think we have to take a hard look.
it like behind the cold storage building and to the
behind the folks at River Drive?
To the west of the cold storage?
Yeah,
agreed.
Where we walked, where the look at the piles.
No, agreed. And the unfortunate part is they got, you know, they were pushed into, they had to do something.
No, absolutely. Yeah,
yeah.
Not
yeah,
helping
and
them
I
at
really,
all.
You're not
but knowing how much we have behind and how much wooded protection there is, I don't care if it's a single boulder that's being stored. If we could swap it to where we could store it where it's a little more hidden, a little less distracting, regardless of where sand and salt ends up, I think it would be worthwhile to look at swapping some of that land.
Would it be possible to make this like an agenda item when we meet on, what are we meeting on this coming Thursday with them, right?
Next Thursday.
Or I'm sorry, the 10th.
Recreation.
All the days are running together.
The 12th, the Wednesday the 12th would be.
But the 10th was when the group from Albany was coming, right? And I mean, if they're going to be here anyway, maybe we can discuss it after the presentation, obviously, because we wouldn't want to hold the guys from Albany up that are nice enough to come up and talk. But maybe we could talk, at least have, you know, 5-on-5, we can talk about it, and then we can make, maybe they can come back with an answer on the 12th.
Yeah, they have two members that will be out of town, so they're only at most for three of them.
Are they no votes or yes votes? I'm just kidding. Let's move on.
Okay. Appointments complete street advisory committee. This is consistent with the policy that we adopted. So Eric Gustafson, Alan Rollage, Jeff Reichensnyder, Chief Love, and Scott Castanay, our engineer. Authorization to bid, this is telecommunication infrastructure construction in conjunction with the Northern Border Regional Commission grant for the 1 gig internet. This is a if we need to rebid it. Monique's been working on this with Superintendent Fayad, and so I'm going to make some calls tomorrow and see if this is necessary to bid. If it is necessary, we're seeking your permission. This will be to run the fiber from Alcoa Road to the San Juan Center Mall. So, Mr. O'Dear.
Second.
Second by Mr. Carver. Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Discussion. Water and sewer bill adjustment policy. I sent you some information, I think, last week. From time to time, we get people that come into the village office. Somehow or another, they always find their way to my office. They've had some type of issue in their home. They've had a leak.
You know there's a sign up that points.
I know. But that's okay. I'm happy to be with you. So they have some type of catastrophic event. Maybe it's just a leaky toilet. Maybe it's a pipe that burst. Maybe they're out of town. They've been on vacation. All right. And then we hit them with a substantial bill, sometimes in the hundreds of dollars. There are a number of communities that have a one-time forgiveness for such a thing. Some communities forgive everything above normal billing. Some give 50% discounts. I'd like to pursue looking at doing something. There's varying thoughts. I know what some people think about this. I know what some people don't think about it. But I don't want to waste a lot of time in it. But the flavor is not, if you guys at least aren't open-minded to it.
My initial thought very quickly was why not figure out a way to help people? And then the more I sat there and thought through the scenarios, the more I thought, are we opening Pandora's box to help a few legitimate, and I do truly feel bad for when these things happen, are we going to open up exposure to those who may not be as honest and forthright? So I'd be hesitant. I'd be interested in seeing a lot more data, number of people
them as much as they wanted and just let it flow, you know, and, you know, that was what it should be. And I'm always wondering that, you know, I feel for these people that, yes, they have a problem like that, but if they leave the electric heater on in their garage, back out, forget to close the door, do they go to Massena Electric and say, I took $20 off my bill because my bill is $20 higher this month because I heated the outside? So, you know, it's kind of a, like I say, you can open up the, I at one time, many years ago, they would give people, you know, one-time credit, things like that. Broken pipe in that building, and somebody's gone away for 2 months and didn't know it was there, whatever. But I don't know. I mean, it's just a, where do you cut it off? That's the only thing I look at is.
To that, the reason I would be interested in seeing more data and numbers is I actually tend to believe that the forgiveness is actually built into our low rates. You know, if you had a program that absorbed more cost onto the water fund, rates would have to be looked at more frequently and go up by a larger margin. And I'd be curious to see those communities that do have forgiveness programs and other so-called benefits, how much higher are their rates? You know, so it's kind of almost like, you know, are they building in a warranty in their higher rates? You know, I can sell you something for $100, I can sell it to you for $125. Is that your risk? If it breaks, you're going to have to pay the $25. I'll set to your $125 and guarantee it. If it breaks, I'll fix it. It's even. You know what I mean? But the perception is, oh, they got covered. You know, so I'd be very curious to see how much we're talking about, how many, the potential impact on the water fund, which would then impact every single ratepayer.
In the same token, years ago, lived here long enough to realize how cold these winters used to get. They used to tell you, let the water run for a while, let the water run. Now, how do you adjust that? So it doesn't freeze, your pipes wouldn't freeze up. There's another scenario, another thing. And the other side of the coin is, if you're going to go away for a while, I'm sure you could have someone take a look at your house. These people, the snowbirds that take off in the winter, they must have somebody checking their house there once in a while for various reasons. And normally, for after the sun goes down, the creatures come out all over town, so you got to be careful. And once you start,
they're visitors.
But the thing is, if you start doing it for one, where do you draw the line? What you're going to do? I understand what you're saying. I don't know.
Have we ever thought of doing? And if I'm sure there's probably a valid reason we don't, so forgive me for asking a stupid question. But monthly, because we only meter every 2 months right now, right? Is that just a
your postage is going to go up.
It saves time. I mean, it's a full morning job for staff to do water bills.
Okay. I mean, I assume
even though the machine does it, it's still a two-person job. Right. It's an office of, you know, there's three and a half people in that office.
No,
that's why.
Okay.
The only reason I'd ever forgive it is if somebody could I think what we're all worried about, you're not worried about the honest person, you're worried about the dishonest person.
Right.
Somebody has pipe burst and they had damage in their house, bring me the service master bill. Show us the service master bill and we'll look at it on a case-by-case basis.
Well, we would, right? I mean, that's, some of these policies aren't like that. They require a bill that shows that there was a repair done. I mean, I think in terms of, you know, someone goes away and they come back for a week and their basement's full of water. So then we send them a $700 water bill. Oh, but wait! You got to pay the sewer too on that.
No, I mean I'm with you.
You know, so in some cases, some people have, let's say, for $1,000 deductible for a water damage like that. So they're out $1,000. We're zinging them for however much we're zinging them for. We should help those people. And there are going to be abuses, but I think we build the system in place for somebody who's reasonable to look at and say no, and this is why now.
Now the bad part is lateral breaks. There's no service master in your front yard.
Right.
So then how do you do that?
Even when it's subjective, though.
Right?
I don't want to be the... I come in with mine, and I think I got a good case, and I know you just took care of Mrs. Smith down the road, and you say no to me, you better be ready. I'm going to be in the public comment session every meeting for the next year.
I mean, I would hope if the lateral broke on the way in, Francis, eventually you'd be able to see it in the front yard, right?
Hopefully.
You know, at 40 pounds.
It's not either.
Huh? No, I'm saying the neighbor might when he sees a big mud puddle in the front yard.
The point is, if the line being embraced, it's not metered, so you wouldn't get a bigger bill.
Oh, true.
Yeah,
true.
The meter, yeah.
True. Good point.
We don't got to worry about scenario.
So we wouldn't have to worry about that. That's a good point. That's twice we've agreed tonight.
Amazing, isn't it?
He's right. And you're right. I don't know, I don't want to close it, but I can see both sides of it. What we're trying to
whatever
do
we
is
do, we'll have to make sure.
And what we don't want to do is give people in that office more to do. They've got plenty to do.
Well, I don't think it's something that you need entirely on staff.
You know, and I meant the double bill, like change the bill.
Oh, right.
Yeah. I don't think that would be a very good idea.
Right.
Anyway.
Right. Well, I'm not hearing an emphatic no, so I'm going to proceed to create some data for you and come up with some options and we'll look at it. Proposed resolution to approve the water supply and maintenance agreement with the town of Northport. Kevin Future is here to answer any questions that you have. This is a project we've been working on for some time with the town of Northport to provide water to Cook Street, Heidi Avenue, and the areas out there. They have a number of wells that have been contaminated, so this is good for us. It's good for the residents in that area. So the first resolution you have is the water supply and maintenance agreement. Trustee Offel, you had a question today on that. I don't know if I answered that.
I believe you did. Which one are you on, Tim? The
water supply and maintenance agreement.
Yeah, it was related to our code. Our code specifically states town of Messina. I just want to make sure that even though it doesn't say town of Norfolk, they're going to be treated the same way as the town.
Right.
Very good. And it does make, I forget what section, 209 section, I forget what section it was. It says that if that's modified.
Yeah, it's 290.10.
290.10.
Yeah, and the section here is I, or L, I'm sorry.
Okay, so if it's, you know, if there are modifications, then they're going to abide by it. And I think it's, if we can help people out, I think it's a great idea.
It's a good point, too, so we'll make sure that they're aware of that piece there.
Yep.
If you've got it, if you wanted to offer anything, or?
I just wanted to let you know that this, Supervisor Fayad made sure that this matched the agreements that you've used with other towns, but there are two changes, minor changes actually, one to your benefit. There was specific reference to your standardization plan for a couple components of the water system that the town agreed to abide by, so those specific types of equipment were specified in the agreement. The other is the standard agreement that you've exercised with other towns is on a 5-year renewal period. We worked this out with your attorney. Rural Development, who is funding the project, including funding the portion that we're going to be getting to next within the village, their requirement on the funding is that the maintenance requirements are in place for 38 years because they are funding service connections into the town portion of the project. So Matthew McCardle agreed that change will be made, so the first effective term of the agreement is 38 years to match the financing period for the RV loan. Those are the only credit.
I won't even ask how they come up with 38.
It's actually, they're allowed 48 years, but because they technically don't close on the financing until after construction is done, so they allow a 2-year period.
Entertain a motion.
So moved.
Mr. Offel, second by Mr. Rivera. Further discussion. Resolution poll individually. Mr. Offeld?
Aye.
Mr. Carvel?
Aye.
Mr. Shays?
Aye.
Mr. Rivera?
Aye.
Resolution carries. Next resolution, authorized Cook Street Waterline Replacement Agreement between the Town of Norfolk and the Village of Messina. Mr. LeBeer.
Second.
Second by Mr. Offeld. Discussion? Resolution?
Yeah, one nasty question now before you
sure.
get that far. Repaving of the street, who's taking care of that?
It's all part of the project.
Is it?
It won't be a full repavement, it'll be a trench replacement.
Where was the trench? Just on the
side? Where the water main is replaced.
Okay.
It's the existing water main is, I believe, just outside the street. The new water main will be just off the curb by the sidewalk there.
Okay, so it's not like you're taking the old main out? Okay.
The old main will be cut and capped and abandoned.
Okay, but it's got to supply water while you're doing the work, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. So the new main has to be put in until it is tested, including the services up to the right-of-way to tie in new services up to the right-of-way line. Once the new main passes the DOH testing requirements, then we can make the taps in.
Okay.
And activate the water system.
What do you do, a pressurized test on it? Or
pressurized
something?
Test.
Okay. Hydrostatic test? Or?
Yeah, there's a maximum pressure loss that they can sustain in the pipe, and then obviously it has to clear the water quality standards for chlorine residual.
Okay. Go ahead, Francis.
Each house on Cook Street now inside the village limits is going to get a new lateral from?
They will get a new connection to the existing lateral from the main to the right-of-way line. We cannot go on to private property and replace their lateral.
So what I'm saying is they're going to be tied into this new line, though.
Correct. So there'll be a new small segment of lateral that ties into their existing lateral at the right-of-way line.
Yeah. Okay. So what I'm saying is everybody's going to, when you get all done, you're going to abandon the existing lines that are on Cook Street now.
Yes.
That's part of the deal, because there's been more flow going through there, so that line had to be replaced.
Well, I couldn't figure out why I said replace that, because it was the Norfolk area. When Norfolk doesn't have
I got tripped up on that first.
Okay.
Yeah, the only concern, I just want to make sure that, because you know how these projects go, you put something in, and it's, well, we really didn't think about that, now people are driving down the road. I don't want that. I understand they're not going to pave the whole street and it can't be perfect. It better be pretty good when they're done, right? And who's responsible for that? You guy, or you're the engineer in charge?
We are.
Okay.
I'm not sure if everyone is aware how this is being arranged. That's somewhat written in the agreement. The money for this was budgeted within the project that the town district approved and rural development approved the funding. Because it's federal money, they're very strict on how this is administered. So the way this was able to be done is the village will actually be putting out their own portion for the Cook Street project as a separate contract from the town portion. The original intent was to do it all under one contract. For various legal reasons, the feds don't allow it that way. So the village will be doing this work once it is certified and approved for the town to connect on. The town can then connect everything that you will have spent to get this project implemented, including third-party construction observation, which would be us. Everything is summed up and called a connection fee that the town then pays and reimburses the village for its expenses. And
so effectively, we'll be paving the street then.
What's that?
Effectively, the village will be paving the street, or will be responsible for paving the street. We're just going
to restoration will be within the budget. That's
perfect.
Just not the entire street.
Yeah, we'll get make sure. I'm sure Haas is all over that.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
No, that's a good question.
You were at your
resolution. Put one individual.
Aye.
Mr. Offeld, who's running this meeting?
No, you were at me.
Mr. Offeld.
Aye.
Mr. Carvel.
Aye.
Mr. Shays.
Aye.
Mr. LeBeer.
Aye.
Just one closing statement. Unfortunately, while Supervisor Fayad was on vacation, I just received approval from Rural Development yesterday to go to bid. So when he returns, I will be speaking to him and setting a date to come back for approval to go to bid on the project. Our intent is to bid both projects at the same time, because we're hoping that by economy of scale and how it's bid, that the prices will be even more competitive.
Nice.
Because understand, this has to pass district formation requirements for the town before even your work can be done. So I will work with us on a date to come back and get your approval so we can go out to bid.
Great.
All right.
Great.
Is it safe to assume that that would, that, yeah, you wouldn't be this far if there wasn't a lot of interest in the town of Norfolk already, right?
They had to pass district formation process, so they had a petition that passed.
Okay.
Before rural development would obligate money to the project.
Now, the
so,
individuals.
Yes, there's interest. In fact, 54 out of, I believe, 88 residents have signed easements to connect to the new water main. Four have flat out said no, they do not want to connect. The others just have not responded, replied, whatever. History usually shows that once you're out there, they decide they do want to connect. And according to rural development policy for the project, as long as the construction contract is still open, they can then agree to connect. Once the project is closed out, then they decide they want to connect. They go through the traditional, you know, connection cost and everything. Otherwise, the cost for connection while the contract is open is part of the budget.
Now, are they paying for it going by their house or not?
The project actually pays to connect into their house. It is a turnkey.
Even if they don't connect to it, I guess that.
Oh, no. If they don't connect, it will be installed to the right of way.
Okay.
A service. So
and they're not, there's no charge. Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Voucher watch.
I move that the voucher signed by Trustee Carville and myself be approved.
Second. Second by Mr. Carville. Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carries. Monthly reports of the Longview Fire Department. Communications. We shared with you the 2015 Water Fluoridation Quality Award that our water department received. And I talked earlier during the budget presentation, but just to let you know, the resource office at the community center that you guys agreed to give that space to is open now. So,
is that, they're open at night, I assume, too?
Right now, just daytime hours.
Okay. Good.
Closing public comment for questions from the media. Give me a brief executive session to talk collective bargaining.
Second.
Mr. LaRue, second by Mr. Rothfeld. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye. Good evening, everyone.